it's a fucking frightening face for people to see when they first tune in.
Well, it's on you now because you're the one who's talking, so. Hi, Jackson.
You're all welcome.
Oh, I can hear. I should close the YouTube page because I can fucking hear myself. There we go. All right. So it's just us then. So this should be about 45 minutes.
I don't know. I'm angry this week. Did you read my column?
I have not read your column yet.
You suck. I posted it specifically for you to read it ahead of time.
Well, give me a minute. The YouTube audience can watch as I read it. Watch along as I read your column.
Hashtag show prep.
Hashtag middle finger emoji.
Our chat doesn't have middle finger emojis, unfortunately.
Your article's not on the website yet.
I know it's not. That's why I sent it in the host thread.
Oh, I didn't even see that.
It's probably because there are 85 messages about dicks.
And so, something, something, titty fucking grandma.
Yep.
6-year-old.
Hashtag Sal's weekend.
But he's not six anymore. He's 7.
Yeah, so those jokes are okay now.
Exactly.
Thank you, Troy.
Jesus, I missed a whole shitload of fucking things here. All right, what do we got? Cruising into the pay-per-view. Why did you put an E in there?
I don't know. That's why I have an editor. I was typing quickly. Fuck off. This is where Adam reads the phone, reads the phone, reads the phone. This is where Adam reads the phone on the rundown. This is where everyone turns us off, turns us off, turns us off. This is where everyone turns us off because Adam's reading his fucking phone. Wait, are Sean and Sal humping now? I agree with that last hashtag, Troy. All right, well, Sal, Adam takes a second to read, to do his show prep now that the show has started. Allow me to inform our viewers that our own rundown co-host Troy received quite the honor this week. he was actually blocked by SmackDown lead commentator Mauro Ranallo on Twitter.
But he did get called a Twitter troglodyte, and that's fantastic.
It is true. That's great. He essentially offered Mauro a little hint that maybe he should stop dropping so many pop culture references, blaming it on Vince in his ear, to which Mauro basically responded, fuck off, you troll, that's all me, shut up and block him. So.
I have to get the Clash of Champions prediction list up, too.
Well, right now we have Jackson, Troy, Sal, and Sean on the side. So maybe we can get some, when we get there, we'll get some Clash of Champions. See, I think they should have put the in and made it Clash of the Champions, because right now the abbreviation is cock. And
but the champions aren't clashing, they're just defending their titles.
On cock.
I enjoy all the different names for Clash of Champions that Troy puts in his articles.
What was that?
I enjoy all the different names for Clash of Champions that Troy puts in his in his power ranking.
Really, all you need to say is cock. I mean,
I think Knight of Knights was my favorite.
This show is like one giant ad for Apple right now.
Well, I'm not using the other laptop, so I don't have the thing that covers over the camera. So I'll just put my finger there. Nobody will know.
Oh, fuck it. We'll see if we can get some of that Apple cash.
They don't give anything to anyone.
I'm sure they give herpes to someone. It's not that long of an article, dude.
I'm on the third down for SmackDown, so.
Troy informing us that the iPhone 7 sucks. Do you own an iPhone 7, Troy, or are you just going off the reviews? Because I'm on the fence on whether I should upgrade. I could use the input.
There we go. There we go. Boom, boom. Boom. Okay. I'm so fucking tired right now.
All right, I'm ready.
It's ready. Patriots gargle my balls. Okay. What is this, 264? Sure.
Oh, yeah. Audible would be good. Audacity, I should say. Audible, too, in case you missed it.
Audible.com. Audibletrial.com/rundown.
Yeah, do that. Except you, Jackson. Don't do that. Everyone else, do that.
Get me $13.
That still wouldn't make up for as much money as Jackson spent on his iTunes this week without asking.
Uh-oh.
Yep. In-app purchases. Fuck off. All right. Ready whenever you are.
Just because it's your birthday doesn't mean you get to spend all daddy's money.
It's true.
All right. Good enough. Fucking who cares. All right. 264. 3, 2, 1. Record. Less likely to finish a story than David Otunga. It's episode 260. Theme song.
The what? The theme song!
Hi, everybody. Welcome to The Rundown. My name is Adam. I'm your host. I have the sniffles. It's Thursday, September 23rd. 2016.
Look at that. Adam playing hurt. Another one of our co-hosts could learn a lesson from that. Just saying.
Jason, if I may.
You keep asking me. It's your show. You may do whatever you want. Go ahead. I might make fun of you later, but you're free to do it. Have at it.
What's up with those twins?
Which ones? They're real and they're spectacular.
Oh, David Otunga. He's so bad at his job.
It's funny because just the other day I was asking Rikishi about him, and he said...
The jokes will never end. The jokes never end. That's pretty fantastic. All right. I thought it was 200% cabbage. But you can think your own things. You want to deal with the voicemail or do you want to talk about something first?
It's up to you. It's your format, sir.
You're so helpful with the input.
I'm just glad that you finally got around to reading the award-winning 3-Up, 3-Down column on questendnetwork.com. Not posted for this week yet. The editor's still finishing it up, but it will be available hopefully tomorrow. And breaking news, Adam, I'm not sure if you're aware of this, we captured an Ernie Award.
What is the Ernie Award?
You can go look that up, but see, every award we win is a legitimate award that you can go look up on the internet and find out what it's about.
Okay.
But the Ernie Award is now in possession of the 3-Up, 3-Down column, so.
Okay.
Let's do this.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am here to talk about Monday Night Raw, the flagship program of the WWE. And you know what? This week's episode wasn't that bad. It was actually pretty good. Now, I know there's this whole dynamic of them doing things on Raw way too soon, but it's a double-edged sword because if they don't do exciting matches on Raw, for example, Kevin Owens versus Roman Reigns in a steel cage, then they're going to get killed by Monday Night Football. Every week they're going to get killed by Monday Night Football. So they definitely need to keep the ratings up. And I think Reigns, Owens, and a cage could have highlighted one of their pay-per-views. And now you've already seen it. But again, what can you do? You gotta keep those ratings up. And I thought it was a good match. I was a little bit surprised at the ending, not Reigns winning, but the aftermath of Rusev coming out and then having Rollins come down to make the save. Why would Rollins come down to make the save other than he said he wanted to be a pain in Stephanie's ass? So I get that connection storyline-wise. But I think we all know that they have been salivating for a chance at a Shield reunion. And even with Dino Machino on the other show, if they can have a reason to get Seth in the ring with Roman on the same side, they will. But I don't expect anything of it just yet. When they do reunite the Shield, it'll probably be for a Survivor Series or a Royal Rumble or something of that nature. Now, as far as the rest of Raw goes, I thought the Cruiserweights got a lot of time, which was surprising.
He's about to get cut off, isn't he?
Fatal four-way, but they got two segments. I thought they all did good, and I actually agree with the winner because you have plenty of time to build up guys like Cedric Alexander and Rich Swann. Give it to the veteran that everybody knows. He can go in there and have an awesome match and put TJ over. I don't think Brian Kendrick should win unless... No. TJ Perkins just won that title. I don't think Brian Kendrick should win at all. But go in there. Put the kid over. Make the crowd cheer for him. And that's what Brian Kendrick can do. Now, one part of Raw that was very confusing is how they took all the mid-carders on Raw and shoved them into one match. It was kind of like they didn't have enough time to go through individual storylines, so they were just going to take New Day and The Club and Jericho and Sami Zayn and Enzo and Cass and Shining Stars and just shove them all in a 10-man tag. And that, to me, was a throwaway. And none of those guys should be thrown away at any time, but God knows I don't want Raw to be 4 hours. But, you know, you could cut out other things, but you know how they are. Although I will say this, I did enjoy the backstage segment between...
Oh, there it is.
Called it.
That's why he was so mad.
Troy, you know Sal, you know the time limits. You might as well just start a stopwatch and you'll know when you're about to get cut off and you can wrap it up.
Last point, you stupid fucking Google voicemail.
But then we
all
missed that.
All I was going to say is I enjoyed the segment backstage between Seth Rollins and Stephanie McMahon. I thought those two have really good chemistry. And I like the back and forth. I actually like Steph saying, well, if I knew that Triple H was going to do it, maybe he would have done it because of this, that, and the other thing. It was almost like when OJ wrote that book, if I killed Nicole, my wife. So that was interesting because they obviously are going to have that play out when Triple H comes back. And, you know, for all purposes, he might be coming back at Clash of Champions. We shall see. Clash of Champions card doesn't look too bad, but what they need to do is further storylines and make interesting booking decisions as far as who's going over in some of these matches. Definitely need to see some titles change hands. I don't know whose, but somebody's got to change hands, and, you know, maybe it's the club. But I'll talk to you guys later, because as Adam pointed out, I always seem to call frequently during the week. All right, bye.
All right, it's Monday Night Raw.
That was a lot of stuff, Sal. Jesus, I don't know if I can even remember everything at this point.
So.
Yeah, I'm going to disagree with Sal on one front. I thought Raw was fairly shitty, personally. Not a fan.
But you always think that. So.
That's not true. I 2 weeks ago, I praised them. I thought they did a much better job. This week, I think it sucked.
It was, nothing is standing out to me in my memory, so it's not.
So I guess we can start with one of the highlights in terms of anticipation. The debut of the Cruiserweights on Raw.
Yes.
Coming fresh off the heels of an amazing Cruiserweight Classic final, we were treated, quotation,
crowning your champion, TJ Perkins,
to a four corners match for the number one contendership to a champion that has not been introduced to your Raw audience yet. We got Cedric Alexander versus Grand Metalik versus Rich Swann versus Brian Kendrick. Yes.
The guy who won the match.
Spoiler alert, dude. So, yes, we treated to a four-way, fatal four-way, number one contender, as Adam just fucking gave away to everybody, apparently. Brian Kendrick wins with the move that's apparently been renamed in the last few weeks from the Bully Choke to the Captain Hook.
That's a dumb name.
Yeah. They're going to, TJ Perkins is going to be repackaged as Peter Pan. And
probably because, you can't call it a choke. It'll remind people of Chris Benoit. You can't call it a joke. So the Captain's Hook.
So what did you think about the debut of the Cruiserweights on Raw as a whole?
I thought the match itself was great. I like they got the show off. I agree with your sentiment and pretty much everyone's sentiment that Perkins should have at least had a face-off with Kendrick after the match, if not, be at ringside for commentary. The fact that he's not there is like, okay, they're going to fight to face him, but if you haven't watched the Cruiserweight Classic, you have no fucking idea who they're going to face. So why would you be at all interested in that at Clash of Champions?
Right. At Cock. If I'm booking the show, I open the show with TJ Perkins, give him a big introduction in the opening segment, have him go one-on-one with someone, Jack Gallagher, one of the other Cruiserweights that we know is there that wasn't on the show the other night, Tommaso, Gargano, one of them. Somebody could go put on a good showcase with, get him out there, get the crowd to know who he is, and then do that four corners match later on, crown a winner, and now your crowd might be actually anticipating the match that you have coming up at Cock. Instead, nobody knows who the champion is. They just know Brian Kendrick, that guy from, 6 years ago. And by the way, a lot of people talking about this. In his little promo there, they muffled it because what most people heard was 600 some odd days since I was fired by the WWE.
Right.
And, obviously that was about 7 years ago. What he actually said was 2,600 and whatever days. But almost nobody heard the 2,000 part, so it sounded like he was an idiot. But he was, in fact, correct. People will know that people will recognize that name. I can see why he got the spot because he's somewhat recognizable to the Raw crowd already. So he'll be in that main event. Hopefully that will sell the angle because they have no clue who the champion is. That he's facing Brian Kendrick at Cock.
Yeah. And I think it was it Sal who was telling us in the host thread that, Vince isn't high on the Cruiserweights. They're going to change. They're going to, take the title off of Perkins at the first pay-per-view, which would be a terrible fucking idea if that happens. Yeah. And I will be extremely pissed. As much as I would be happy for Brian Kendrick, I would be extremely pissed if that goes down on Sunday. But we'll talk about that later.
Yeah, I can't imagine they would have put the championship on a guy only to have him lose it. If that was the case, they would have probably just had Kendrick go over in the tournament.
Right.
But who knows how it
would completely undo the entire point of the Cruiserweight Classic.
No, not necessarily. I mean, Perkins was the best of that group in that particular tournament. It doesn't mean he's never going to lose to any of those guys.
Well, no, but Kendrick was also in that tournament.
Sure. And he lost to Kota Ibushi, who TJ Perkins beat.
Yeah. Anyway.
But, can we talk about the next thing that pissed me off on Monday Night Raw?
Sure.
So we got, and this is not necessarily in and of itself bad, but we got the sixth match in the best of seven series between Sheamus and Cesaro. Mm-hmm. And you know, shockingly enough, Cesaro won to force a match 7. Mm-hmm. And right on the fly, Mick Foley decided to do it at Cock because, you know, I'm sure that was never part of the original plan. It was just right off the top of his head, the way he came up with that. I was about to say whip it off, and then I realized that, you know. Anyway.
He whipped it out at Cock.
Yes. See, I was trying to be subtle. You went right for the obvious. Yes.
That's how we do around here.
Right, exactly. Yeah, the problem I have is that you've now had 6 matches in this series, and you've done nothing to distinguish any of those 6 matches. There was no submission match. There was no 2 out of 3 falls, no steel cage, no nothing. It's been 6 matches that have been relatively the same between 2 very talented guys. And I will say this.
One of which was not even on TV.
Sheamus has very much impressed me in the series. I think he's really kind of shown what he can do in there with someone talented and put on some really good wrestling matches. But other than that, and they're fighting for this obscure title shot somewhere down the line. We don't know what title. Maybe they'll just present the winner with the European Championship. Who the fuck knows?
I love those promos where it's like where Sheamus is talking, and I will get what I rightly deserve, a championship opportunity. Like, okay, just fucking be specific, would you?
Yeah. It's kind of bullshit. But the way they've handled this whole thing has just been an absolute mess. Hats off to the guys. Great in-ring work. But the story and the way they've booked this is just horrendous.
Yeah. I want to see that championship opportunity be for, like, the tag team titles, and they make Cesaro and Sheamus team up.
Well, then, what were they fighting? Well, I guess then again, that would probably follow the logic train they would use. So.
Exactly.
Yeah. So there was that. I don't know. Did you have any thoughts on the Sheamus Cesaro situation?
Yeah. I mean, I haven't been looking forward to this best of 7 since they announced it. And like you said, they haven't done anything to make any of these matches special except, his back hurts. Can he still win if his back hurts? So, and like I said, one of the matches not even being on TV certainly did not do anyone any favors, but we all knew it was going to go to 7. We all figured out pretty quick that the 7th match would be at Clash of Champions. So
Cock.
It's foregone conclusion at this point that Cesaro goes over and gets his championship opportunity. But which title? I say he wins the championship opportunity and then goes to SmackDown to challenge for the Intercontinental belt. Because I think he'll be much better, much more better used on SmackDown.
He's no Jack Swagger. Thank you very much.
And thank goodness for that.
Cesaro on the social medias this week made a little bit of a thing when somebody asked him about his music, and he said basically he's been trying to get new music since they gave him this music.
Yeah, so, I read that.
Not a fan of the music he has, apparently.
Nope, not at all. Not at all. Yeah, I think I actually had that in my notes. Yeah, I liked his original theme song. I don't mind the sirens, but I understand, you know, the James Bond thing. He wants something more espionage-y.
I don't think anything they've done with Cesaro is right in terms of the way they've packaged him. But, you know, the package that he has is headed to Cock and could come out with a championship opportunity. So, you know. Yeah. Troy suggests that the stipulation be loser kills themselves. Sean, not to be outdone, says that was the stipulation of the Booker T. Benoit best of 7. How Chris Benoit killed himself.
Sean, you slay me.
Like, and Benoit did to his family.
Exactly. The dogs are in the enclosed pool area.
Too soon?
Too late.
To save their lives. Also, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I thought, this actually applies kind of to both shows, but I thought the idea of having commissioners and GMs was so Shane and Steph wouldn't be on TV all the time. And yet they're still on TV all the fucking time.
Yeah.
Although I'm intrigued by the seeds of dissension they keep planting between Stephanie and Mick, and I hope that pays off somehow. But it's just like, okay, you don't both need to be there. You can go on vacation at some point or do something else.
Yeah, I'm a little disappointed. I thought we were going to get more. To be fair, I really think Daniel Bryan has taken kind of the lead role on SmackDown way more so than Shane. Shane's kind of stuck to the background a little bit. He shows up every now and then, but for the most part, I think Shane's filling that role we kind of expected from the beginning would happen when they announced the GMs. But Stephanie's got to be front and center because they're doing this angle with her husband. So,
Speaking of which, I actually have a note about that as well. We're to believe that, you know, Stephanie and Hunter are married. Presumably they live in the same house, sleep in the same bed, eat at the same dining room table. And Stephanie has not once been like, hey, so what the fuck was with that on Raw the other week when you showed up and cost Seth Rollins the title?
Yeah. Yeah, I honestly, like I said, I'm all for a good slow burn angle, but you have to throw a little bit of paper on the fire, a little bit of wood on the fire every week. You can't just completely ignore it because at this point, I'm not sure anyone cares about the Triple H, why Triple H did what he did or where it goes at this point. Now, that said, we're going to get to this prediction. I think we're going to see Triple H at Cock getting involved in that main event.
Yeah.
You know, costing Seth Rollins his Cock win. Hey, if they put the logo around the ring, does that make it a cock ring? Is it a yes?
And was it me or was Stephanie acting particularly heelish again this week after being?
Well, she started off face and then for the last 2 weeks. And yeah, that's what she does. That's the problem. Nobody on this show has any direction. Nobody, you from 1 week to another. There's no consistency. There's no, and this is what gets to me. Sal touched on it in his voicemail, and I'll expound on it here a little bit. You've got 3 goddamn hours for this show, and you told us from the beginning that you had to have more talent because you had 3 hours to fill. That's the story you told going into the draft. So if you have all this time to fill, that you need all this extra talent, you shouldn't be pigeonholing 10 guys into a meaningless 10-person tag match.
I was just about to talk about that.
Instead, they should be showcased. They should be front and center. And your GMs and your authority figures should be getting less backstage time. Because, spoiler alert, no one gives a fuck about Stephanie. Realistically, much as I love the guy, nobody gives a fuck about Mick Foley. The only backstage segment that I enjoyed on Raw was Chris Jericho and Mick Foley with the list. That was it.
The list of Jericho.
And here's another thing with Jericho, and I know you want to talk about the 10-man tag, and we will get there. Here's the other thing. Everyone gives so much credit to the New Day and Enzo and Cass for their great comedy routines and how they, you know, they never have a bad night. Fuck that. The New Day has had a lot of bad nights. Let's be honest. Mm-hmm. Let's call it what it is. I can't say call a spade because we're talking about the New Day. I'm just saying it could be taken the wrong way.
And you can't say call a club because we're not talking about the club.
Exactly. Enzo and Cass have had some really bad nights on Raw. We talked about the pregnancy giving birth in the middle of the ring angle. One person who, no matter what kind of shit story they give him, makes that goddamn thing work and makes it entertaining as hell is Chris Jericho. Oh, never has a bad night. They give him Jim and Marvin Luter, and he makes it work. I don't know who's better at making really bad things work, him or Matt Hardy, but it's close.
Yeah, that I was going to say, speaking of having no direction whatsoever, was ten man tag.
On the side, apparently my son's getting caught up on the thread. He says he can't wait for the Booker T and Benoit best of 7 series. He wants Booker T to win.
Yeah, good choice.
Okay.
Yeah. For one thing, we get that segment with Jericho reading the list, the list of things he doesn't like about Mick Foley. And then he's interrupted for no goddamn reason by Enzo and Cass. Oh, my God. And then the fucking Primo and Epico, which I thought the Shining Stars gimmick couldn't get worse, and then timeshares. But, you know, and then the New Day, and then the Club, and it's like, and then Sami Zayn. And why the fuck, why are you out there? Why, there is no reason for anyone to come out during that segment. There's no reason for any of those people to make an appearance. Maybe Sami Zayn, because they're feuding currently. But there is no reason for anyone, any of those tag teams, to appear during that segment, because none of them have anything to do with Chris Jericho at this point.
It's to the point now where Lucha Underground in 1 hour can squeeze in almost as much in-ring action as Raw does on a three-hour yeah. show. Don't get me started on Impact. Impact, you know, you can say what you want about the company itself, but the in-ring product has gotten a lot better, and they're putting guys in the ring and letting them wrestle, and Raw just doesn't do it. There's just way too much stuff that's not wrestling. If they're not, you know, pimping us or selling us on something or putting their Intercontinental Champion in a fucking chicken suit or, you know, whatever the stupid thing that they're doing that's not wrestling, it's getting to the point of being borderline unwatchable. And this week was, you know, people are saying this week was not bad. I thought this week was horrible because it's a go home for a pay-per-view.
To go and home for their first brand exclusive right. pay-per-view of this.
And I left there split. Saying, what am I supposed to be excited about? Seth Rollins jumped 4 feet off the announcer's table, and I swear to God, they acted like it was Shane coming off the Titantron. he's off the top of the Hell in a Cell got less reaction than Seth Rollins jumping, making a 3 foot jump from the announcer's table to the floor.
Yeah. And Rusev being pushed gently off that 4 foot stage next to the announce table fucking killed him.
Yeah. It is. Now Rollins coming off the cage. That was impressive. Of course, the timing was off. So Owens and Rusev were standing there like assholes waiting for him to actually make the jump. But that kind of stuff happens. Speaking of which, for me, perhaps the highlight of the night was during that segment at the end. I don't know if you caught this, but at one point, Kevin. Yes. Yes.
That was my favorite thing ever. That was going to be my. I contemplated making that my lower third this week, but yeah, Matchka something.
Yes.
Fucking Kevin Owens. Speaking of never having a bad night, holy shit, Kevin Owens, amazing.
Yes. Yeah, and Kevin Owens is a great example of what guys like John Cena talk about all the time. If you ever listen to their promos, I mean, they're out of character interviews. Guys have to be willing to take a chance. You have to be willing to get in trouble. You have to be willing to fail. You have to be willing to go out on a limb. And Kevin Owens is successful because he's not afraid of doing those things. They're not scripting for him to yell that stuff during matches.
Right.
That's just him in there going, in this moment, this is what feels right, and doing it. And it works, and it gets him over, and he's the Universal Champion. So these other guys in the back need to come up.
I actually hashtagged that on Twitter during Raw, too. Hashtag Matchka something.
Yeah, but that was probably on, like, Wednesday. So.
No. Fuck you. I thought the ending of the cage match was fucking lame as shit because it's like, double escape. Oh, Roman dropped first. Okay. All right. But,
you know, it's a way of ending the match without Roman really showing dominance over the champion. So I was okay with it. You put the guys in a steel cage, what are you going to do? It is what it is. You have to have a winner. You can't have a count out. You can't have a disqualification. So,
but then we get Rusev and. Owens.
Troy says, how can we not be excited for cock? It's going to be huge.
But then we get Rusev and Owens locking Reigns in the cage from the inside. And Rollins has to run down and climb the cage to get... Just raise the fucking cage back up to the ceiling. And, you know, do it because it goes up. It goes all the way up. You don't... They're not
Are you talking about cock or the cage?
The cage. Both, but okay. Yeah, that didn't make sense to me because they show it because it's not like the one that they assemble at ringside during the commercial break. This was hanging from the ceiling the entire night, so you can just put it back up to the ceiling and Seth doesn't have to climb and jump or do nothing.
But then he doesn't get over it. Baby face pops. Yeah, and that was kind of the other thing. I took out of Raw. We talked about how they weren't beating us over the head with Seth Rollins as a babyface. Well, on Raw, they decided to. Everything was focused on Seth being a babyface now. everything he did, everything way he acted. I will say this. I did enjoy his match. I enjoyed the fact that now that he's at an actual babyface, his moveset matches his character more, but he's also much more fast-paced in the ring. So he was obviously slowing it down and working more of a heel style back then. But I think the style he's working now as a babyface, that faster moveset, I think it just fits him so much better.
Yeah. But was that his consequence, having to fight Rusev on Raw? Was that his for interfering last week?
Yeah, I know, right? I have no idea.
Anyway, anything else to say about Raw? But,
by the way, what Kevin Owens forgets is that Rusev's probably tired because he's been machkaing that box since their honeymoon. So, you know, probably worn out, if you know what I'm saying. yeah, we didn't talk at all about the woman's angle from Raw.
Oh, yeah.
I have a lot to say, but why don't we let you express your opinions on
it? It honestly made me wonder if the whole Sasha Banks double shoulder thing last week was on purpose. And if not, they just went, oh, shit, we have to cover for that. And so now it's a triple threat at Clash of Champions. And Dana gets her foot in her mouth again, boy howdy. I mean, I'm okay with the triple threat. I mean, it puts Bayley in the title picture, which is something we were complaining about last week. I mean, she's not going to win, but it puts her in there. I mean, it kind of furthered the whole Dana Brooke Charlotte breakup thing that they're kind of running with. But I mean, I think it's going to be a good match. I'm looking forward to the triple threat.
Yeah, I'm sure it's going to be a perfectly good match. I don't think there'll be any problem with what they'll do in the ring. My problem is with the angle. You touched on it. The way they got here was, I think, 100% accidental. I don't necessarily think, but I think everybody was pointing out the double pin so much that they felt they had to address it.
Yeah.
They couldn't not touch upon it. So they did, and the result was they took.
You couldn't just say, hey, the ref didn't see it. Sorry.
They took the biggest possible match they have for their women's division. I mean, this match would be theoretically on par with that WrestleMania triple threat we got if and when they decided to do it, when you took Bayley and Sasha and Charlotte and put them in the ring together. And instead, as typical, as has been the case with this women's division, and this is a horrible turn of phrase to use in this description, but they've blown their wad every time they've had a chance. It's, oh, well, we've called out Bayley. Well, let's go right into giving Sasha Bayley versus Charlotte.
Yeah. Well, they're
hold off.
To be fair, they're women, so they can blow their wad more than once. But anyway.
Anyway.
Completely kill it dead. Okay.
Hashtag the female orgasm is a myth. Anyway. I don't understand why they do it that way. I don't get it. They should go and watch what the women are doing on SmackDown and realize I heard a great analogy between Raw and SmackDown. SmackDown is the wrestling show. Raw is the soap opera about running a wrestling show.
Yeah. And that's what it was during the initial brand split too, is Raw was focused more on story. SmackDown was focused more on action.
Right, but Raw's not even focused on story anymore. It's like a reality show. It's like the Kardashians in the WWE. It's like, well, how are we doing this? And who's dating who? And who's married to who? And whose wife is the... Who gives a fuck? At the end of the day, the marquee still says wrestling, and you have to deliver logical wrestling storylines, and they can't do it anymore on Raw for whatever reason, or they refuse to.
Yeah, whatever that split in the creative team was when the brand split as well. Raw seems to get all the people who don't know what the fuck they're doing.
Well, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Ryan Ward, who used to be the head writer for SmackDown, for NXT, is now the head writer for SmackDown, which makes sense when you look at the product.
That would explain it, yeah.
Yeah, it makes it much more, it looks much more NXT, much more based on the talent and the in-ring product, and I think that's to their benefit. And SmackDown is getting to the point where they're running neck and neck with Raw in the ratings department, and that's fucking scary if you're Raw.
Cruiserweights should have gone to SmackDown.
Sure. Yeah. You gave Raw every goddamn advantage going into this. the extra hour, the extra draft pick, the cruiserweights, most of the recognized titles with the lineage, and they still can't deliver. That's frightening. Like, at some point, somebody in the back, in the company, in the main offices, up in Titan Towers, or whatever the fuck they call the place, headquarters now, needs to look at that and go, the fuck are we doing? And people give me shit sometimes on social media. And, oh, you obviously, you know how to run a company better than the guy who's done it for 10 years and made millions of dollars. And no, that's not necessary. I'm not saying I know how to run the company better.
Yeah, Jason, how's your promotion doing?
Right, exactly. What I'm sitting here telling you is that what they did for a long time worked. It doesn't work anymore. It's not working anymore. Your fan base is rejecting it. And instead of looking at that and saying, how can we adjust and give the fan base what they want, what they're doing is instead saying, fuck you, fans. You don't know what you want. We're going to tell you what you want and keep shoving it down your throats.
Hashtag Roman Reigns.
Well, that's a great example. And you know, I'm a Roman fan. I don't have a problem with it. I'm not one of the Roman haters at all. But you're on the go-home episode of go-home episode of Raw before a pay-per-view. The focal point should not be Roman Reigns in the main event on Raw. It just shouldn't be. The focal point should be the champion and the champions. But instead, the way they booked that, the focal point of that match was Roman Reigns.
Right, getting revenge for last week.
Yeah.
Okay. With that, we can move on to this.
I can't wait to talk about the CWC this week.
Hey, how you doing? It's your boy, Tommy Montesanti here. And this morning, you can call me Tommy Creamer because I'm at the D&D trying to get some good old coffee in that cold brew style. But I want to talk to you guys about Tuesday night SmackDown Live. I thought the show was amazing. I thought it was really good. There's a lot of good things that happened on SmackDown Live. But unfortunately, you know, I got to stop with the bad. Apollo Crews. Is this guy the next Curtis Axel? Is he the next Bo Dallas? He's getting buried. He's not even looking competitive against Baron Corbin. And they're just using him to set up a feud with Corbin and Jack Swagger. So, what are they doing with Apollo Crews? He gets no mic time. I know he has no personality anyway, but this dude is literally being wasted, and he's going to end up being the next Curtis Axel. It sucks. I have no problem with Apollo Crews, but apparently they do. Also, speaking of people getting buried, I like the fact that Miz got protected in that IC title match. They kept the belt on him. They had me. I actually thought when Maurice got sent to the back that they might give the title to Big Love. But the problem is, as good co-host Jason had pointed out, Ziggler's story hasn't changed in months. He's the guy who's going to do the big fight, his last chance. And every time he gets his last chance, he doesn't win. So do me a favor, huh? Turn this guy here. There's no point in him doing this shtick continuously. Look what it did for AJ when they turned his heel. AJ was amazing last night. Now, next week, we're going to get the rematch with AJ Styles and Dean Ambrose. I don't think they're going to switch the belt, but I think it's a ratings grab. I think people will tune in to see AJ versus Ambrose. As far as the women go, Becky and Alexa Bliss killed it in that opening promo. I love the work they're doing. I'm actually really looking forward to this match. Talk to you guys later.
I mean, nobody thought I could be a Kent State Hall of Famer, but I did it. And nobody thought that I could make it in the WWE, but I did it. And I know right now, nobody thinks I can beat The Miz and become the Intercontinental Champion.
And you didn't.
Exactly. But that's it. That's the promo we've gotten since before SummerSlam. And it's almost comical at this point.
Yeah. It's getting a little ridiculous.
Yeah. I mean, I just gave credit to the SmackDown writers for a bunch of things, and that's one thing I'll have to give them a demerit for, if you will. But do something with the guy. One way or another, just do something. You can't keep going to this same well over and over and over again. At some point, there has to be a payoff to this.
Yep. yeah. I liked the ending of that match. I thought it was really clever how they had. She almost got caught. They dropped the thing, and as soon as he dropped the thing, I'm like, I bet that's coming back. And then distract the ref with the belt, spray him in the face with whatever the fuck that is.
Hairspray.
And then roll him up. Did you happen to notice, like I happened to notice, that the entire upper bowl of the arena they were in was curtained off on Tuesday night?
That's not uncommon. It depends on the size of the arena. I don't know off the top of my head what arena they were, but there are arenas that seat more people. And
the whole balcony. There was nobody in the balcony.
It's also not always the same all the way around. They could have people on the hard cam side that are not. Yeah, you can't always judge by that. Those things, those pictures, those images, the way it looks on TV can often be misleading in terms of that stuff. But SmackDown still doesn't have the general buzz when it comes to your town that Raw does in terms of ticket sales. True. And, true. You know, hopefully they'll get there at some point. But
So we open with a contract signing, the first ever SmackDown Women's Championship contract signing. And Daniel Bryan says that they're going to be civil. There's going to be no violence. And the crowd boos.
Yes.
And he chides them for booing. And then there's violence. And the crowd boos again. Like, make up your mind.
Seriously.
New graphics for the Usos. About time.
You just skipped over the rest of the women's segment, you fucking sexist.
Just going by my tweets.
I thought the women killed it in that segment, honestly. I've been critical of Becky's promo ability the last few weeks.
Yeah.
But I thought she did a really good job. Maybe she's better in that format where she's got someone to play off of right there and someone to kind of confront her.
As opposed to just talking to the interviewer.
Yeah, exactly. But I thought she was much better. I thought for her first time out in that kind of situation, Alexa absolutely killed it. Mm-hmm. And I've said this before, and I'm such a huge fan when they do segments like this of having these ladies come out in street clothes. I think it just adds so much more to it. I think Charlotte looks so much better when she comes out in her street clothes instead of the silly things they do where guys who aren't supposed to be on the show come running out in their ring gear. It doesn't make sense. It's not logical. I wish they would do this more, but they've really taken a point of doing it with the women on both shows, and I think it's a nice little touch that adds to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I thought Becky's promo was great. He wasn't born to be a champion, was born to be, a mill worker in Dublin, and I followed that crazy advice to follow all my dreams, and now here we are. Becky definitely, or Alexa rather, doing her thing. I've been a fan of Alexa getting this title shot since she won last week, and so I'm really looking forward to what they do. And this just kind of sold the whole thing that I think they're going to do great on Sunday, and I'm really looking forward to that match, definitely.
Troy points out that Becky did the Ziggler promo better than Ziggler does it, which is probably true. So after that, we had the Usos. You were just about to talk about the Usos. We already talked about the IC title match, so we can kind of get over that.
Yeah, the Usos finally got their new graphics, so they're not neon puke anymore, which is good.
Yeah, I very much disliked this. Very, very, very much disliked this. Not because I don't like the Usos. I think I've said it here before. I'm a big fan of the Usos. Even when before this heel turn, I thought they were vastly underutilized as a tag team. I think they are in ring one of the best tag teams the company has, if not perhaps mm-hmm. the best.
Yeah. So this was Usos versus American Alpha for a number one contender shot at No Mercy for the SmackDown Tag Team Championships.
Yes.
Even though, as you pointed out, and as makes sense to most everybody else, American Alpha shouldn't have to earn that shot since they were taken out of the tournament and would have had a shot at. Backlash, but whatevs. We got to further the Chad Gable's knee hurts story, and they lose again, which I know you were not particularly happy with.
No, I'm not a fan of how they've used Alpha at all since they've come up. I think they're setting these guys up for failure. I think they're setting them up to be another team that nobody gives a shit about, and that's really disappointing because these guys can be very special if they're booked correctly. Mm-hmm. I understand that there's a long history of, you know, you bring guys up slowly, but you didn't book these guys slowly the way you brought them up. You booked them as a big fucking deal when you drafted them, when mm-hmm. you debuted them, you attempted to make them. Now, you didn't use them on the first episode, so you didn't make them feel that special, but you did promote them as being a big deal. You drafted them earlier than any of the other NXT guys. And then you bring them in. And then the first week, they're not on the show. And the second week, they come out. But then the rest of the roster and the tag team division comes out and kind of takes some of the thunder away from Alpha's debut. And then 2 weeks, three weeks later, they're in the tag tournament. They win their first match decisively. They beat the Usos in 30 seconds. Then they just get the shit kicked out of them. And they're left laying, which is fine. I have no problem with that. That's all part of storytelling. I don't like that it took them out of the tournament, but we've covered that. Mm-hmm. But then they come back. And here's where I really lose faith in this. They come back to no advertisement, no promotion. No, this week American Alpha is back. They're looking for revenge, blah, blah, blah. Instead, they come back to an unadvertised match with the Usos for a number one contender shot that they shouldn't have to earn. And they get pinned clean. There's no cheating. I mean, they took out Gable's knee, but that's not cheating. It's legal.
Yep.
Clean pin and left them laying again. Now, there are those who will sit there and tell you that that they're building a storyline, that they're going to end up chasing the Usos, and that's all well and good. But did you hear the crowd reaction to American Alpha's big return this week?
Oh.
There wasn't much of a reaction.
I was going to say, I can't say that it did.
And that's my point. They haven't built these guys up to the point where that angle means anything yet, where that beatdown angle and that chase angle means anything yet, because the crowd hasn't attached to them yet. I pointed out in my column this week, when the Shield debuts, if the Shield debuts and week two they get laid out by somebody and week three they get pinned clean, you're not sitting here with all three members having been world champions, I don't think.
Right.
How you debut people and how you introduce them to the crowd and the perception you give your crowd of a new talent when they come up matters, and it stays with them. And it's hard to reverse that once the fans have that opinion. You made the fans think that these guys are not special in the way you've booked them.
Mm-hmm.
What I would have done, and yeah, it sucks for these guys, but have the Hype Bros out again in a number one contenders match. Have the Hype Bros out, Usos go over, then American Alpha's music hits, and they come storming out and beat the shit out of the Usos for revenge.
Right.
That's how you reintroduce them. They go to the back where they're getting interviewed, and again, they attack from behind and take out Gable's knee. You've kept Alpha strong while keeping them out of the title picture.
Mm-hmm. You've told the exact same story.
Exactly, but you did it in a way that doesn't make them look weak.
Yeah.
And I have serious concerns about what's going to happen to American Alpha going forward if that's how they're booking them fresh out of the gate. But maybe that's just my take. I'm interested to hear your take on it.
No, yeah. We talked about this in the host thread as well. Basically exactly what you just said, that it does, you know, further the story that, oh, you know, Chad Gable is injured, you know, Jason Jordan trying to take one for... And that's the story they were trying to tell on SmackDown. Is, you know, Joe Jordan was more concerned about his partner than you know, possibly, you know, winning the contendership. But, you know, taking one for the team as opposed to, you know, putting his partner in danger. But yeah, the clean pin certainly doesn't help anything. And the fact, like you said, that if you knew them from NXT, then you know the backstory. If you haven't watched NXT, a lot like what we talked about with Raw with TJ Perkins, if you haven't watched the CWC, if you haven't watched NXT and you didn't know who these guys were before they came up, then they've done nothing to show that they're anything more special than any of the other tag teams. And yeah, he made a big deal. Daniel Bryan made a big deal drafting them, make a big, you know, big pomp and circumstance, American Alpha. And then this is what we've gotten so far, and it's really not doing them that many favors to especially the clean loss this week.
No. And where they should be the focal point, the Usos have become the focal point. And to me, that's a problem. I understand. And a lot of this traces back to the fact that they decided to make the tag team titles about the comedy act. And I really think that's kind of where they went off the rails, because in order to do that, you had to take one of these two teams that should have been in the finals out of the finals. And that's where that's how we ended up where we got to.
Right.
And even, okay, again, same theory. If you go to the last pay-per-view and the Usos lose the titles to Rhino and Slater because Alpha runs out and costs them the way that the Usos cost Alpha, okay, I can live with that. Again, they've done nothing to make American Alpha look special or look strong. To this point, since their debut, they've been pushovers for all intents and purposes.
Mm-hmm.
Save for that one win against the Usos, which they just made look like a fluke because the Usos just beat the shit out of them.
Yeah, that 30-second right. 30-second victory.
A 30-second win, people will sit there and go, oh, it looks, that must be dominant. It's only dominant if they follow it up. Other than that, it's a fluke. You know, yeah. we've seen in UFC, if it's told us anything, it's that sometimes the underdog can win one night with one punch, but then goes out and loses the title in the rematch or lose right away because they're not the better fighter.
Right. So for everything that SmackDown's doing right, they're still not getting their tag division completely correct.
They're doing well with the Usos. That's the thing. I like what they're doing with the Usos. I very much enjoy the Usos heel. It's like they sat around and said they had all these great heel ideas that for all these years they couldn't use, and now they're trying to get them all in at once, and it's tremendous. I'm very much enjoying it. I just think the way that they're utilizing Alpha is a big mistake, and it's going to be long-term detrimental to their brand because you need Alpha to be strong if they're going to be one of your top teams.
Right. Okay. Again, we get Curt Hawkins, and again, Curt Hawkins doesn't wrestle. Don't know why that's happening. Give the guy a match or something. Then the Intercontinental title match, we already talked about that.
Speaking of greatness of the Usos, I love the backstage segment with Slater, Rhino, and the Usos, though. That was a nice touch. Rhino eating the crackers. I pop for that every time, as stupid as it is. I don't know why.
I'm going to slap those crackers out of here. You don't touch my crackers.
Right, yeah.
okay. Then the women's match, which I actually missed because I was doing prep for supper for the next night. So I did not see what there was of a women's match on SmackDown, which ended in the dumbest disqualification in quite a while. But, you know.
On one show, how could you do so well with your women's division and then so badly with your women's division, all within the span of 2 hours? Because SmackDown figured out a way to do it. Yeah. You started with that great contract signing segment, which we talked about. And then you get to this match and a tag team match, and it's great. You get a little backstage promo with Nikki Bella and Naomi, which I thought they did okay. Nothing special. I mean, Nikki seemed...
But Nikki called her Trin.
Yeah.
Kayfabe, bro.
I do like Naomi's tagline of it's glow time. I thought that was kind of cool. but, you know, then you get to the match. And I understand you want to tell the Bella versus Mella story. I understand that. But the way they did it was way off base. Because what they did, for those of you who didn't see it, like Adam, because Adam doesn't pay attention to women's wrestling because he's sexist. The reason, what happened was they got to a point in the match where Natalya was covering Nikki. Carmella pulls Natalya off, thus costing her own team the win, potentially. Throws Nikki out to the floor, throws her into the barricade, at which point she's disqualified.
Yeah, it was very reminiscent of, for a long time listeners, way back when Cesaro started using the giant swing and he swung, I think it was Miz, back and forth into the barricade a bunch of times, and then we had somebody put the sideshow Bob stepping on rakes over it, which is still one of my favorite things that's ever happened on this show. But yeah, just back and forth a couple times, referee calls for the bell. Because why not? Why not?
Now, we've watched Roman Reigns spear motherfuckers through the barricade. I know Bell. And that's fine. That's how it should be. We've watched Shane. We've watched people put people through tables with no Bell. For some reason, Carmella throws Nikki into a barricade. And
Carmella, who is a member of the match, who is a participant in the match.
Right. I don't get how that's a disqualification. And I would. Now, there are rumors that they might be setting up at their next pay-per-view for a no DQ match between the two.
Daniel Bryan did mention that on Talking Smack.
To which I ask, we haven't had a regular match yet, much less need to attach that kind of stipulation to it.
Yeah, but speaking of logic, you do have to remember that this is the same company that has disqualified wrestlers in tag team matches for the non-legal tag team member hitting the legal member of the other team. So,
yeah, I'd probably lose my shit if I saw that again, too. So,
all right.
Well, and then we had our main event.
Then we had our main event. Dean Ambrose versus John Cena.
Oh, wait. Apollo Crews fought Baron Corbin.
Oh, yeah. That happened.
And then we had our main event.
And Apollo, Apollo Crews said fuck on live TV. He got bleeped. He got bleeped, but still.
Happened before. It'll happen again.
Yeah. Fun note. Cena versus Ambrose. And you're going to yell at me for spoilers again, but this this loss to Dean Ambrose, this clean loss on a non-pay-per-view standard singles match, was John Cena's first loss on television, well, first loss in a standard singles match, non-pay-per-view, since October of 2009, when he lost to Triple H on an episode of Monday Night Raw.
I have to go back and look. That sounds... I swear I've seen him lose. But anyway, it doesn't matter. Point. When was the last time Cena won a match? A singles match. Honestly, and this is, I'm not bullshitting here. I'm legitimately... Because I don't remember. It's been that long since John Cena's won a singles match that I can't remember the last one he won. Because he's lost to AJ every time.
It was Kevin Owens last year. Anyway. That's
so we're looking at roughly
that's
roughly,
just dead air, so
we're looking at roughly a year or so, correct? I mean that's as far as I can remember. Since his last actual singles win in a high profile spot.
I'm trying to remember the last time he had a singles match on TV.
let alone
winning a singles match on TV.
Yeah, it's been a while. But in any event, so here's the thing, and this is what I touched on in my column this week. I don't have a problem with John Cena losing a match. He's been doing a lot of it lately, and that's fine. The problem is that the way they did it, I think, didn't maximize a Cena loss. At this point, for what you say about the guy what you want, he is the face that runs the place is not a joke. I mean, he's the most marketable, the most recognizable. He is the face of that company for right now. To have that guy lose in a unadvertised, meaningless pinfall on SmackDown, I don't think that's getting the most out of that loss. Mm. I don't think that does as much for Ambrose as a victory over Cena should do. You look at what the victory over Cena did for AJ, it really propelled him into the legitimate stratosphere of heavyweight championship contenders. And he cashed in and won the championship, as well he should.
Right.
But a win over a guy like that in a high profile spot can really elevate your credibility with the viewing audience. I don't think they got that with this match, and I think that's a mistake. I think that was a waste. I think had they even built it last week and said, hey, you know, after on Talking Smack, after they closed Raw with him hitting the dirty deeds on Cena, you know, Daniel Bryan gets on Talking Smack. You know what? Next week, these guys are going to go one-on-one right here on SmackDown. I think that would have made a world of difference for this. I think this seemed thrown together, and the result being a quick kind of pinfall. And I don't know about you, but I was watching. I go, holy shit! Did he really just win that match? Sunset.
It was a little sudden. Yeah, a reversal of the AA into a you know, sit out to a sunset flip, basically.
Yeah. So I don't know.
It certainly was a startling pinfall. Was not expecting. It was very sudden, but. But yeah, I thought the match itself was pretty decent. Jason is engrossed in the chat room.
Sal says I'm kissing Cena's ass. I'm not sure how I'm kissing his ass. I'm simply stating facts. I mean, you tell me, Sal, who's more marketable in that company right now than John Cena?
Yes,
and not in terms of who you would buy something from. But in terms of general merchandise sales, you tell me who touches John Cena in that company right now.
All right.
Okay, yeah. Troy points out a couple weeks ago, John Cena beat Alberto Del Rio on SmackDown leading into the pay-per-view. I did forget about that one, but he is correct. Yeah, but
that's Del Rio. It doesn't fucking count.
He wouldn't have beat him if he wasn't about to go on wellness suspension.
Okay. Yeah, so next week on SmackDown, they announced this on Talking Smack. Speaking of announcing things on Talking Smack, next week on SmackDown, Dean Ambrose gets his one-on-one rematch for the
incorrect.
WWE.
Incorrect. Daniel Bryan came out and announced it on SmackDown.
Oh, that's right. It was on SmackDown. Then he ran to Talking Smack. That's what the joke was. That's right. So, yeah, so that's how we end SmackDown Live. Next week on SmackDown, I thought you were saying the match was incorrect. I'm like, no, I'm pretty sure that's how it goes. But it was on SmackDown, not Talking Smack. Dean Ambrose gets his one-on-one rematch against AJ Styles for the WWE World title before the triple threat at No Mercy.
Yeah, which, again, I'm not a fan of. I think that doesn't need to happen there. I don't think it serves any purpose. I don't think there's a single person that's going to watch that's going to think Dean Ambrose is going to win that match.
Yeah.
I think all it does is waste the opportunity to have that rematch and have it be a meaningful, anticipated match. But
I don't know. They could surprise us, and then Dean will be a two-time champion, and then AJ Styles will be a two-time champion after the pay-per-view.
No. And that brings us to the best show WWE puts on every week.
I just had a note about Cena that I had, and I disappeared. He is going. He's, you know, he was obviously not going to win at No Mercy because he's going on his hiatus again to film American Grit. It's going to be pretty much the same schedule as last year's hiatus. It leaves the middle of October, comes back for the Madison Square Garden Christmas show. That's basically what we had. Exactly the same thing happened last year. So be on the lookout for something to happen at No Mercy that'll put him out of action for 4 months. 2 months. 2 months. Oh, the only other thing I want to mention about SmackDown, because it made me laugh, was when Daniel Bryan announced the title match for next week, the crowd booed because they're selfish assholes.
I think we're seeing Dean is not as over as we're starting to see the reality that Dean's not as over as people thought that he was. I mean, they're booing him attacking Cena, and a year ago, who would have thought that would ever happen? Usually anybody that attacked Cena got a rousing ovation. Yeah. He's getting his title match, and ironically enough, I'm starting to come around on Dean Ambrose's character since he lost the title.
Yeah.
The fans are turning on him. But I'm starting to come around on him.
I don't think they were booing Dean Ambrose. I think they were booing the fact that they don't get the title match.
I think that was part of it. But if you go back last week, they did boo
Ambrose. Oh, yeah, when he attacked Cena, absolutely. Yeah. Which is why I thought maybe he was turning heel, but apparently he's not.
Slow burn, Adam. Everything has to take 7 months to happen. I think if you watch, all right, so we can go through Talking Smack real quick. The first segment Carmella was on, really nothing happened.
For being a princess of Staten Island, she really doesn't have an accent that doesn't.
She kind of a little bit Worcester kind of accent. Yeah, kind of weird,
kind of Worcestery.
A little Worcestery. Yeah, it's in the Worcestershire sauce. that's what. Never mind. I was gonna make a joke that probably would have. Yeah. Anyway. Yeah,
because that kind of joke has never been made on this show before.
Her segment was fine. Take it or leave it. It was nothing special.
I thought the ending of it was just dumb. Where it's like, you don't tell me when this interview is over. I tell you when the interview is over. Ask me another question. This interview is over. Like, okay, fuck you.
Yeah, it was almost like that's going to be a catchphrase, like for her to just dismiss people. But whatever. It's fine. It was okay. And Daniel Bryan goes on a rant about some documentary that apparently they filmed about him leading into WrestleMania that they've decided not to air. Release the bear. Trying to prompt people to get the company to release it. I don't really. Sure. Okay. Yeah,
pretty much.
I will say that I enjoy Daniel Bryan's I don't give a fuck attitude on Talking Smack. just says whatever. There's no filter on this guy, and that's great. Yeah. And it's, you know, conspiracy theories on the internet, like he's going to push the envelope because he wants to get fired so he can go wrestle somewhere else. you know, because Brie doesn't want him to wrestle. So as long as the opportunity is there for the WWE to cash that check, she's going to want him to stay there. Yeah, if he can get himself fired and he doesn't have that WWE paycheck anymore, she might have to acquiesce to him wrestling again.
Yeah. I had to watch Talking Smack twice because for whatever reason on my feed, it kept freezing a lot. And then after it, I thought it like they'd done some sort of shoot thing with it because once it cut to, once he started doing the whole release the bear thing, all of a sudden it like froze. And then half a second later, I was watching a Ricky Steamboat documentary. I'm like, did they cut the feed? Cause he was wait, going wait, out of line.
Are you time traveling involuntarily now?
Apparently.
That could be a problem.
So I had to go back and watch the thing again so that I could watch the Dean Ambrose.
If you time travel back to the night you were conceived and your dad sees you and you freak him out and they never have sex, you may never be born.
It's like in Back to the Future where people just start fading out of pictures.
Yeah, that could happen.
Was that the NBC chimes? What the hell was that?
I have no idea. Then we get to the main event of Talking Smack, which was Dean Ambrose. And I got to say, I thought Dean Ambrose was fantastic here.
I
thought he did a great job. Yes, Sal, I said I thought Dean Ambrose was fantastic. I thought he went out there. He did a good job kind of portraying himself as the common guy, the everyman. You know, I still get dressed in the locker room with the boys. The Samoans, which are heels right now, so he probably shouldn't have said that. And Jack Swagger, and that's going to be some interesting conversation that goes on in that room between Dean Ambrose, the Usos, and Jack Swagger.
Couldn't be any more interesting than that conversation between Baron Corbin and Eric Rowan.
Actually, I can tell you exactly what the conversation is. The conversation is Dean going, "Hey, Swagger, I bet you won't call yourself Jumping Jack Flash out there."
I bet you $5.
Yeah, I'm thinking that's probably it. So, and then he talks about how Cena gets dressed on the tour bus and doesn't, he's not one of the boys anymore, blah, blah. I thought he got the point over well. Mm-hmm. I would have liked it if he was focused a little more on AJ and the championship than he was on Cena.
Yeah.
But, you know, it is what it is. He's got a championship match next week. I would have thought his character would be more focused on getting the title back. I liked that he looked at Renee and said, "Sometimes I don't even listen to what you tell me." And she was like, "What?" I thought that was
well good. After last week, after the pre-backlash episode where everybody made fun of Renee for picking her boyfriend in her prediction for the title match.
But I particularly enjoyed the same where he says, "I don't care what John Cena says about me, and I don't give a damn what Stone Cold says about me." I thought that was nice. I thought that was a good touch. Everybody sat and watched Austin openly criticized this guy. Now, he didn't have the balls to say this in front of Stone Cold, which would have been even better. He'd have earned some points if he had. But now that Stone Cold's not there, he could talk shit. And he says, "I don't care what Stone Cold thinks." And I thought that was good for his character to show that he really is this guy that doesn't. And this loose cannon Dean Ambrose I like a lot more than crazy Uncle Dean.
No, absolutely. 100%. I was actually just going to say the same thing. I like serious crazy Ambrose, as opposed to goofy, crazy Ambrose.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. So more promos like that, please.
Yes.
And less Turd Ferguson hats and nut shots.
It's a big hat.
It's a big hat. It's a funny hat.
My podium is gone. It was here a second ago. It's gone now.
Burt Reynolds. That's not my name.
Ferguson.
Yeah, what do you want? You buzzed in. No, I didn't. Anyway.
I'll take the penis mightier for 500.
But will it really mighty my penis? It's not ape tit. It's a petite. You know what? Never mind.
I could watch those things all day long.
I think they need to release just a DVD of those.
Seriously.
My wife and I still from time to time will from the one where Tom Hanks was on and his hand is just stuck in a pickle jar. It's like, "How did you get your hand stuck in a pickle jar?" "Oh, I wanted a pickle." Anyway, now that we're completely off topic, let's talk about NXT. Shall we? I have to get to that voicemail and find my speaker. There it is. This one.
you know, in response to that voicemail intro that Adam leaves when you call the rundown voicemail, is the Seth penalty fighting Rusev? Because, you know, oh, never mind. All right, just real quick, couple thoughts on NXT. Samoa Joe coming out there with the medical records, listing off everything he's done to Nakamura, talking about his recovery time in 6 to 12 weeks, saying he won't wait 6 weeks, he won't wait 12 weeks. Regal needs to come out there and award him the title. That was great. That was absolutely great. That was like some classic heel shit that you would have seen like the Million Dollar Man do, or somebody like a Jim Cornette. That was amazing. Also, the fact that Joe said that he's now going to decimate Regal's entire roster until he gets what he wants, that's going to make some interesting NXT shows over the next couple weeks. I think we all know Nakamura will defend his NXT championship against Joe in Canada, but that's not till November, so it would be interesting. I do like how they're playing this out. I think at one point, Austin Aries attempted a GTS in his match. That went horribly wrong, and the camera had to cut away real quick. Don't do it. If you can't do it, don't do it. And as far as the main event between Cien Almas and the NXT debut of Cedric Alexander, what a great match. That was a great match. That was a perfect 15-minute match for the main event of NXT. Loved it. Thought that was absolutely perfect. That's about all I got to say about NXT, other than the women that they're currently have in the division, they just don't feel important. I don't know, maybe because they don't cut promos, maybe because there's no build to their character. You know, I think Billie Kay's a good wrestler, but I don't, you know, she doesn't feel big time like Charlotte did or like Sasha did. I don't know. Maybe I just got to give them a chance. But even Liv Morgan, she just seems out of her league standing next to Asuka. But I'll talk to you guys later.
Liv Morgan, who looked like she'd been crying before her promo even started.
Anyway, I love Liv Morgan. I don't care. I'm a big fan of Liv Morgan.
Okay.
I mean, they say you only live once, but I could live multiple times. I'm just saying. But speaking of the women's division, where the fuck is Peyton Royce? I mean, we talk about Billie Kay, and Billie Kay's all well and good, but I think Peyton Royce is far better in the ring. I think she's sexy as hell. I think she's very marketable. It's a factor in terms of your marketability. I think she's someone that you could make a focal point of that women's division at this point. And she's just been completely AWOL from TV.
Yeah, until you mentioned her, I had basically completely forgotten about her. Yeah, they've decided to go with Liv Morgan versus Asuka. But like you mentioned last week, there's really no build to this at all. Just Liv Morgan,
yeah, Liv Morgan and Asuka is clearly just a TV angle. I don't think they're going to carry that to TakeOver. I would be shocked if they did.
So this week she cuts another promo where, like I said, it looks like she'd been crying for a day. And then Asuka comes out, tells her she has her match, and so maybe that'll be next week.
Yeah. I will say this. One person I do like in the women's division that like what they're doing with it is Mandy Rose. I think we touched on it earlier. She was in that six-woman tag a few weeks back. I thought she has a good look. I thought her promo was not bad for, you know, first real time out doing a promo on TV. Mm-hmm. I thought it went well. She's got a great look. She seems to be getting the hang of things in the ring.
Yeah.
That's a girl that might be a factor down the road for that division.
Yeah. Was not the biggest fan of hers on Tough Enough, but seeing her now, like I said, in that tag match and now this promo, I really think she's coming along quite well. So
yeah, she's clearly put in the work. So,
and we also need that other Tough Enough woman. What the fuck's her name? The one who was doing the MMA. What the fuck? I forgot her name completely.
Daria.
That's what. Yeah, Daria. Anyway. So we opened NXT with me just fucking around on Snapchat using the voice changer filters over Samoa Joe and posting those to my story. So that was entertaining. But Samoa Joe promises to run roughshod through the NXT locker room until he gets his title match. And Regal comes out to chastise him for doing that.
Yeah, I agree with Sal. I loved that segment. I thought Joe was tremendous. Joe is just amazing. Joe can do anything.
He really is, yeah.
And I will be absolutely enthralled with what's going on anytime Joe's on the screen. And I'm still heavily and openly and unapologetically campaigning for WrestleMania to feature Samoa Joe versus Brock Lesnar, because who the fuck else is Brock in the face that's going to get you as excited as a Samoa Joe Brock Lesnar?
I know a lot of people are looking forward to that, so hopefully that's what it comes down to. I still
to this day do not understand how we got to the name Oney Lorcan. I still have no idea what the fuck that is. I've never heard that anything resembling that name ever. And I still don't really like it as a name, but good for Biff, I guess.
Sean on the side says, don't forget anal burn covers.
Bum. Anal bum cover. That's another Celebrity Jeopardy thing. Anal bum covers. Anyway. Yeah, Oney Lorcan. Anyways, Mike Rome and I had a nice brief conversation on Twitter during NXT this week. Now, we've got this promo for this new fella.
Did he block you?
No, he didn't.
Okay.
This new fella, Dan Matha.
Yes.
Just show how huge he was, how huge he is. People will be impressed. Nobody will wonder how well he can wrestle.
Was that Tino Sabatelli?
I have no idea. No idea. I didn't.
Looked like I couldn't tell, but I know that's the guy down in NXT that's kind of really jacked and cut up. And I think he's a former football player. He was featured on Breaking Ground. I don't know if you even watched that.
I didn't get a chance to watch that. I think I watched one episode of that.
Time traveling. Adam should go back and check that out because it's. I don't know if that was him. I thought it was, but I saw it very quickly. I didn't see a ton of it, and there wasn't a ton of it to see. So
yeah, that was just a little 30-second vignette of here are some muscles. Oh, it's Dan Matha.
Right.
In 2 weeks.
So I'll have to do a little research and find out if that's somebody else or if it is Tino Sabatelli. Overall, I thought it was good NXT. Yeah, it was not. Nothing especially exciting. I would like to see some work from the Revival. It seems like it's been forever since we've seen them.
Yeah, all we got was the fallout from the CWC finale where they tried to attack DIY in the parking lot.
Yeah,
and got run off.
Now onto the Cruiserweight Classic.
Yeah. speaking of which, though, Cedric Alexander. I do want to talk briefly about Cedric Alexander. I'm a fan of his, and I like the fact that they keep mentioning, you know, he cut weight to make sure that he made the cruiserweight the weight limit, because that means that should he feel the need, and he wants to bulk back up, he can certainly be an Intercontinental or a U.S. title contender. I can certainly see that happening in the future as well.
Well, only the U.S. title, because you know he's a cruiserweight, he's on Raw.
Hey, you know, when your contract comes up that very same week, you can jump to the other show.
Speaking of Raw, let's go back to this for 1 second because we're talking about cruiserweights. We talked about the lack. How fucking amazing would it have been on Raw if you go, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome, opening the show, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our new cruiserweight champion, TJ Perkins. He comes out, he cuts a little bit of a promo, interrupted by Neville. You know, hey, kid, I want to see what you've got. I've been here for a while, blah, blah, blah. And those two could have a phenomenal fucking match.
Oh, hell yeah. That'd be great.
TJ goes over. He gets the rub of beating a guy who's been on the main roster. Mm-hmm. It's tremendous. You establish, you know, Neville is a guy who could compete in the cruiserweight division and hang with those guys. And I think that would have been a phenomenal way to do the show.
Yeah. But then we don't get that whole great thing of Mick Foley reading awkwardly from cards in his pocket.
Well, you still could have done that because the Fatal 4-Way could have still happened.
Yeah, some people are crapping on it. I really like the fact that they gave the cruiserweights their own color scheme, the purple and silver in the aprons and the ring posts. I thought it was a nice way to differentiate and make it feel special.
I feel like it'll be a couple weeks thing, and then it'll kind of go away, and that's fine.
Either way, I just like that it was a thing that they did. Like I said, kind of differentiate, make it feel, hey, this is important. We're doing special graphics, so. Raw cruiserweights. All right, that's really all I've got for that.
Sorry, I didn't mean to sidetrack on Cedric Alexander. Yeah, I'm a big fan of Cedric too. I thought the match with Almas was really good. I think Almas is great in the ring. It's just a matter of they haven't found a way to get the character over yet.
Yeah,
He has stopped doing the Godfather meets Los Barriquas, which is good. He just comes down the ring in his gear. That's an improvement.
Yeah, the match itself was really good. I like them going back and forth. He hit that double moonsault spot much better this week than he did on Austin Aries last week. He loses again, but you know you got to put people over. So
yeah, I think he's going to continue to lose and then snap and kind of go heel and maybe maybe even put on the mask, become La Sombra again.
Hmm. We'll see if it'll help them find a way to use him. Then I'm for it. So. Because those are the big things, is Alberto Del Rio leaving. He's like, oh, you know, Andrade Almas is not happy where he is either.
Well,
let's just spread that shit out the door while I'm leaving.
Well, would you be happy in that scenario? I wouldn't blame him.
Yeah. Okay. I have a couple of things that I wanted to talk about, and then we get to the predictions. So it is prediction week again. Because that's what happens when you have pay-per-views every two fucking weeks. There was rumors this week that, according to the Wrestling Observer newsletter, they're considering putting together a shooters stable.
Yes.
Thinking maybe Shelton Benjamin once he heals from his surgery, Jack Swagger, Dolph Ziggler. Apparently, they were going to do this with Chad Gable in NXT, but it got the kibosh. So now they're thinking of doing it on SmackDown.
They started to do it on. NXT, they had Sawyer Fulton and Angelo Dawkins in the singlets, and they were getting ready to do the thing. And
I do remember that.
It just kind of fell apart, and then they just looked like idiots. So.
And now Sawyer Fulton has something else that's coming up on NXT in the next couple of weeks.
Yes, and we could get into spoilers on X. We've talked about that guy on the show recently as to where he was. But yeah, some of you have seen those segments for Sanity, and if you don't want to be spoiled, I would say fast forward maybe a minute and a half from here.
Yeah.
But yeah, so
although considering that we just said Angelo Doug or Sawyer Fulton's name and now we're saying this, but whatever.
Yeah. Spoiler alert, Adam, Sawyer Fulton's not the main fucking event of this group. so apparently those
are trying to throw them off.
Now you've talked so long, they're back. They fast forwarded and now we're going to spoil it for them anyway. I think for those of you who have seen the little vignettes for Sanity, unfortunately, it is not Vinnie Marsaglia. We were hoping. Just going to a little ink on the top there. But no, it's actually going to be Eric Young leading a faction called Sanity with Sawyer Fulton and a couple other people. I forget off the top of my head. One, a chick, and another guy. But
Looking forward to it.
The guy is one of the Australian guys or something like that. But in any event, new guy from down in NXT. He's been there for a while. Wolf. Alexander Wolf from Germany. That's who it was. They're gonna form a faction. It'll be the first real faction I can remember in NXT. I don't think we've seen that before. So it'll be interesting to see what they do with it.
Yes, I'm looking forward to that because I know that Eric Young can pull that off very well. So.
Yes. And another spoiler alert, that came as part of the Dusty Rhodes Tag Team Classic, which apparently is taking place again this year. But based on the matches and brackets I've seen so far, is far less star-studded than it was last year. I mean, last year we saw the debut of DIY in that tournament as a team.
Yeah. We're not gonna have
We had Joe and Balor as a team. You had and who could forget Baron Corbin and Rhino? You had American Alpha. You had the Revival were in there. You had really good teams. The Vaudevillains. Yeah, I think they were.
I thought
before they were really a thing.
I was gonna say I thought they debuted. I thought the whole Chad Gable Chase thing happened after that.
I think they lost in the first round. I could be wrong though. Enzo and Cass were in there.
Somebody will Google it.
Yeah, an exciting bracket there, and this year doesn't quite seem to be as exciting.
Well, all the good people went to the main roster, so.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you got TM61 versus the Authors of Pain.
Again.
Yeah.
Okay, what else? They announced the DLC for WWE 2K17. This week we'll be getting Eddie Guerrero, Papa Shango, Ty Dillinger, hooray, Luke Gallows, Carl Anderson, Kerry Von Erich, Mojo Raleigh, The Godfather, and Austin Aries.
I'm sorry. They've just told Troy that it's going to have Luke Gallows, but he's not going to actually be in it.
You lost me on that.
Every week before the show, Troy in the host thread says, oh, Luke Gallows is there this week.
And he that's Luke Harper.
Luke Harper. Sorry. Yes. Sorry.
He's going to be on the regular roster. Yeah. So the club's going to be in there. We're going to get the perfect 10. Hooray.
He coming out with his really cool jacket, his vest there?
I hope so.
Ty Dillinger.
I hope so. And I'm also excited that Austin Aries is going to be in there as well. So that game comes out on October 11th. I am taking the day off of work and off of trivia that night so I can spend the entire day playing. And then there'll be a review up on the questendnetwork.com. So be on the lookout for that. I will also probably stream most, maybe not all, but most of that.
Can I make a suggestion? I would maybe do that as a special collaborative episode for the Geek and Gamer Guild.
We were thinking about that. Troy's now off the chat, but
I think that would make a very good cross-pollination, a wrestling video game. And
yeah, I told him because we were actually talking about listeners and promotion and stuff. And I told him if he does a wrestling video game episode, I will post it as a bonus episode on our feed. So. Be on the lookout for that if that ever happens. But I'll probably stream that on Twitch, most if not all of that marathon on October 11th. We'll go up on Twitch, so be on the lookout for that. I'll link that on questendnetwork.com as well under the live stream section. So that's going to be a thing that's going to happen on October 11th, so that'll be fun. I'm really excited for this game. I'm really glad that they brought back the backstage brawls and whatnot, so hopefully it harkens back to the old SmackDown games where you could do that last man stand or false get anywhere match, start in the ring, and then go backstage during the match, which they haven't done in a long time.
I played 2K16 a few times. It was nice. The graphics were cool. My favorite part was doing the Royal Rumble. I played as Classic Sting, and I was playing against my son, and I just kept eliminating him every time he would slide in. I would grab him, whip him in, and kick him out. So he played with every character other than Sting because I was number one. And I just kept eliminating him until he cried.
He played with every character for 2 seconds.
Yes.
2K16 is decent. 2K15 is shit. Don't buy 2K15. But 2K16 is pretty good. And as we've talked about, they actually done away with showcase mode this year. So I don't know what they're going to do for unlockables, but we'll see. Anything else? We could talk about Paige if we want to. We can talk about TNA being for sale if we want to.
TNA's been for sale for a while, but it sounds like...
Awesome Kong joining the cast of Netflix's new Glow series.
So we could start talking about something, and then you can start going on to something completely fucking different. You buried the lead. Apparently Cody Rhodes is going to debut for TNA this week.
Sal is supposed to be on the side here keeping an eye on TNA to let us know what his stupid ring name is, but it's probably just going to be
tonight's Cody. Episode was taped in advance, so he does not appear in front of the live crowd. We can confirm that. So it's going to be some type of video package, pre-taped kind of deal. Yeah. His wife. It'll be interesting to see what name they give him. I'm telling you,
he's going to be Cody. She's Brandi Rhodes, so they can introduce them as Cody and Brandi Rhodes and not get fucking sued.
See, I think the Rhodes name is what the trademark issue is. It's not Cody Rhodes per se. I think it's the name Rhodes that they have.
I don't think so, because she is Brandi Rhodes.
That's what I'm saying. That's why I think they may have struck a deal where Cody can use that name.
I don't know.
We'll see. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah. But yeah, TNA's for sale. WWE supposedly put in an offer, but that's just for because they would just buy them for the tape library. Everybody's saying, WWE's going to buy TNA, but it would only happen if they were the only buyer in contention.
Which begs the question, if WWE were to buy TNA, who are the talents you would like to see them actually keep and bring into the roster?
Oh, it's been so long since I've watched TNA, but...
I know you wouldn't pick Jade or Gail Kim. We already know that.
Well, I don't think Gail Kim would pick herself in that situation.
Well, now that they've got a women's revolution, she might be happier.
Mike Bennett, absolutely.
Yeah, Mike Bennett. I think Mike Bennett would be phenomenal in NXT. Honestly,
absolutely. They can bring back Derek Bateman.
Mm-hmm. I'd love to see EC3 in WWE. I think they really missed. They don't often completely miss the ball, but I think they did with him. And they might have with Eli Drake, too. I really like some of the stuff he's been doing.
I don't know who that is. I don't watch TNA. And they can bring Moose. They can bring Moose in.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of Moose, but I would love to see Decay brought in to NXT. I think they'd be a really nice addition to that tag team division.
Well, that leads me nicely into another story that I have here. You know who they're thinking about bringing in, whether they buy TNA or not? Apparently, Triple H is very interested in trying to get Matt Hardy to sign after his contract with TNA ends. Yes. There's a big thought that it's not something he'd be interested in based on the perks he has in TNA with the schedule and whatnot, and how much money he's making off of indie dates and his own merchandise and all that. But
so here's the thing: by all accounts, if everything Jeff is not in terms of handling your money, Matt is. So Matt's done a very good job.
Right.
Of handling his money. He's got a very nice little nest egg saved up.
He's got a drone, for Christ's sakes.
And there's, well, that's actually Jeremy Borash's drone. So he's in charge of all the drone shots and the whole production of those delete, decay, and final deletion things. Those are all Jeremy Borash. So it wouldn't, despite the fact that he may take a small hit financially going back to the WWE, I got to think for a guy like Matt who actually is really into the history of the business. And I think there's definitely a part of him that would relish the opportunity to end his career in the WWE as opposed to languishing in TNA for the rest of his time.
Yeah. I mean, the point that I saw wasn't that it was really a money thing. Cause as you said, he's living quite comfortably at this point, dollars wise, it was just a schedule thing. Whereas, you know, in TNA, it's a very light schedule with them doing tapings once every other month or so. And then, you know, he can do the indie dates if he wants to.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, the full-time WWE schedule is 300 days a year.
Yeah.
250, however many it is at this point. So. So we just got mentioned on Twitter by Tommy Moltisanti. So I'm going to see what that's about. But yeah, so it'd be interesting. Oh, it's just the video from Impact of Cody Rhodes. So. This little vignette, he's getting into a car and driving around. Interesting. Anyways. So that's all I had, unless you want to talk about Paige. But...
Oh, we can talk about Paige. It's not going to hurt. I mean, we're definitely below Troy time at this point. So. Paige returned to WWE this week. Her suspension ended. She was back to being backstage. Eva Marie's suspension also is ended. She is off shooting a movie. So until that's done, they're not going to bring her back on TV at this point. The report
that I saw said that WWE had the rumor was that they had made the decision to fire her before her suspension, but then they mended fences and now she's coming back. Claimed last week that the suspension was not for a failed drug test, but a procedural issue because she wasn't home when she was supposed to take the test. So she didn't get to submit her pee in time.
Which I think we speculated on at the time that it was a possibility that is part of the policy, the drug testing policy, which is you have to, if you miss a test, you fail a test.
Yeah. Yeah. And we talked about that when we were talking about Roman too and trying to figure out. Yep. Speculate what Roman had been suspended for. So, but she's back, back on the road. We'll see how long it takes to get back on TV if they have anything new with her there.
Another person we talked about briefly was Summer Rae. Apparently, also dealing with some type of a neck injury.
Oh yes, she posted a picture on Instagram that everybody thought was her in a neck brace. It was a cervical stretch collar, basically something that'll loosen the spinal cord in the neck area. But the rumors that she is battling neck injuries. I think I heard an elbow injury as well.
Yeah,
just some nagging stuff that's keeping her out of the ring.
Yeah, she had been working house shows up until very recently, but now she's on a little bit of a break.
Yeah, finally, actually got an MRI and was determined that you shouldn't be doing this.
Yeah.
Um. Yeah. So I've, at this point,
Coco Shot says Summer Rae injured her neck, tilting it to the side so often to call Timmy.
At this point, I've forgotten what brand Paige is on. Is she on SmackDown? Paige is on Raw. She's on Raw. That's right, because Alberto was on SmackDown.
She's a Raw.
Okay. Do you have anything before we go to the predictions?
Oh, I think that's. I think I'm good.
Okay. So, from bottom to top, the kickoff match: Alicia Fox and her magic box versus Nia Jax. That still makes me laugh. Anyways. Alicia Fox versus Nia Jax. Is there any doubt that Alicia Fox wins this match? No.
Unless she fills her magic box with rocks.
Ooh, Dr. Seuss.
And clocks her in the head.
Possibly on purpose this time. No, Nia Jax is obviously going to kick the shit out of Alicia Fox.
Wait, hold on, hold on. So she should put rocks in her magic box while she wrestles Nia Jax on Cox.
Well, it's just Cock, though. There's only the one.
It's champions. Plural.
Nice. All right.
Yeah, Nia Jax is going to win that.
Yeah, obviously. Sami Zayn versus Chris Jericho, and what might be the match of the night?
Yeah, it could very well steal the show, and I have no idea which way they're going to go. Gut instinct would tell you it's more useful for Jericho to put Sammy over. Mm-hmm. That said, I get the impression this is probably going to be a multi-show program, in which case Jericho probably wins here.
Yeah, gut instinct tells you Sammy's going to win, but gut instinct means nothing when we're trying to do this. So I'm also going to have, given how they've liked the Sammy being the lovable loser, as it were, we'll put Chris Jericho in the win there. Up next, we've got TJ Perkins defending the WWE Cruiserweight Championship against the Brian Kendrick.
I'm just going to call him Captain Hawk.
Yeah, we talked about it earlier. I don't. If they take the strap off of Perkins this early, I'll just be so mad that I may throw something through my TV. So I'm going to stick with Perkins on that one. You just dab. Dabbing doesn't work in an audio podcast.
I'm dabbing on him like TJP because TJ Perkins is going to win this match.
Yes. Match 7 in the best of 7, Cesaro versus Sheamus for the championship opportunity.
I'm going to go with Cesaro.
Yeah, definitely. 100% agree.
You know what would be great, though? End it in a double fucking count out.
We're going to overtime, McMahon.
No, not a time limit draw. A double count out, because then they've both lost. Nobody gets a championship opportunity.
Your best of 7 has ended at 3-3-1.
Yep, 3.5 versus 3.5.
Raw Tag Team Championship, the New Day versus the Club. Is this finally when the Club takes the titles?
I've said so many times that I thought this was when the New Day finally would lose, that maybe if I say the New Day will win, they will actually finally lose it.
It's so like when the Usos
I'm going to go New Day.
Yeah, it's like when the Usos kept defending against the Wyatt family, and I kept saying that the Wyatt family had to win, and the Wyatt family never fucking won. Sal, I already made that joke earlier, but that might have been before we were recording. I don't remember. Anyway, I'm hoping that we get the Club here, because if we don't get the Club here, I feel like the next 2 months are just going to be throwaway matches so that the New Day can beat Demolition's record. But I'm going to hope, once again, that it's the Club that goes over and takes the titles here.
Oh, I think it's going to be the Club. I'm just picking the New Day in a reverse psychology situation so that the WWE, who clearly listens to this podcast, will put the belts on the Club.
Yes, there we go. Raw Women's Championship, Charlotte defending against...
Still sounds bad every time you say it. Go ahead.
Sasha Banks and Bayley in a triple threat match.
This one's probably the toughest one for me to call on the show.
I think so. No, I agree.
We know that Charlotte only really has the belt because they thought Sasha's injury was going to be worse than it was. The plan as of this point was for Sasha to still be the champion.
Right.
We know that this is a hot shot for Bayley to even be in this match, in this program at this point. So I don't think it's going to be Bayley.
Mm-hmm.
I think Charlotte could easily spin off into a non-title feud with Dana if Dana costs her the title here.
Yep.
So I guess I'm going to go Sasha.
Yeah. I'm thinking Sasha, and as much as I don't like it, I'm thinking Sasha. That doesn't make sense. I was gonna say Sasha pins Bayley, but that doesn't really make sense.
That's actually what I think. They've spent so much time playing up the sister angle between Sasha and Bayley that I could very easily see Sasha kind of cheating and beating Bayley, and hey, it's all fair in love and war. And then those two can spin off into a program while Dana and Charlotte spin off.
Yeah, because I was going to say Sasha pins Bayley, that way Charlotte has a has an excuse to go back for the title. But if you're going to have Charlotte and Dana, then you're going to have Sasha and Bayley. So that makes sense to me. So I'm going to also go. Are we agreeing on every match so far? No,
because you keep stealing my predictions.
Because you picked the New Day. United States Championship, Rusev versus Roman Reigns.
You go first this time.
I don't really care. But
well, first off, is the match actually going to happen?
Why? Because Rusev got thrown off that 4-foot stage on Raw?
Well, no, because they were supposed to have this match at SummerSlam, and they just decided, fuck it.
Oh yeah. Fuck it. Hopefully it does. Maybe they'll put it in a cage this time. I think...
No. We can't have a cage on the actual special event of the pay-per-view. We got to save that shit for Raw. This would have been the spot for the cage. Why they...
Well, when you're giving away the pay-per-views for $9.99 a month, you want to draw this.
Technically, every pay-per-view is now $5.
Oh, because there's two. That's right.
Yeah. But I can't.
Those TV ratings, motherfucker, to get that advertising money.
Do you remember the last? I mean, Hell in a Cell at WrestleMania, but short of that, do you remember the last like gimmick match we've seen at a pay-per-view? It seems like we see that so much less than we used to.
Yeah, it was. They did Elimination Chamber last year.
Yeah.
As just a random network event.
And I mean, I'm talking anything like 2 out of 3 falls, nothing. I don't remember. They seem to have first blood, last man standing. I don't remember any of those things.
I feel like there was a last man standing a little while ago. Because somebody made the duct tape joke, which always makes me mad because that fucking pisses me off. But anyway. Yeah. But again, somebody's going to post over here on the side that, it was like 3 weeks ago, dicks. Yeah.
It seems like an element of booking that they seem to have gone away from for some reason.
Okay, so Rusev versus Roman Reigns. I think... I think they might put it on Roman, to be honest with you.
Interesting. I think the last time they were in the ring, Roman got the clean pin. I think Rusev, there's no reason to switch it here, so I'm going to say Rusev goes over here. And now's where Adam switches his prediction and says, you know what,
In the Universal Championship match, Kevin Owens versus Seth Rollins, you talked about it earlier. The thinking is that Triple H is going to make his grand surprise return here after his grand surprise return 4 weeks ago.
Yeah,
and
cost Seth's going to be about to win. Triple H is going to come out, cost him the win. Owens going to, yep, because we're gearing up for Seth and Triple H. Probably at Survivor Series.
You think they can slow burn it out to WrestleMania?
Because Survivor Series would be great. You know what would be great for Survivor Series, though. All joking aside, and it would have to be a relatively fast program, but there's enough seeds planted that I think you could do it if you do it right. You're in Canada for Survivor Series. How about we do Owens and Jericho? How fucking tremendous would that be as the main event for the Universal Championship?
But they're best friends.
But that's the whole thing. You know? Oh, Jericho runs out to help Owens. Owens isn't there to help Jericho. Why, you know, I got your back. Why are you not treating me like your best friend? Blah, blah, blah. Seth can go off with Triple H. I think that's, to me, that's the money. That's the way to go.
Yeah. But isn't there all these rumors that we're going to get a Shield reunion at Survivor Series?
I don't know. Okay, so let's say Shield.
That's what everybody's screaming for.
So you get what? The Shield versus Triple H, Kevin Owens, and Chris Jericho?
Yeah.
That wouldn't be bad. I wouldn't hate that.
All right. So that is all the matches that they've announced so far. And that's all that I've got.
Braun Strowman will probably beat up a jobber. I did enjoy on Raw the Let's Go Jobber chance. That was...
Yeah.
Yeah. And for those of you wondering at home, that was not actually legitimately Michael Hayes' grandson. Yes. That was a rib.
All right. So on that clarification, I'm going to say that does it for the rundown for this Thursday, September 23rd, 2016. 397 days since the New Day won the WWE, the Raw Tag Team Championship. For a free audiobook and a 30-day free trial, go to audibletrial.com/rundown. Elkmania 4 is this Saturday, September 24th at the Beverly Hudson Elks Lodge in Beverly, Massachusetts. Find the event on Facebook for more information. Liberty States returns on October 8th with Fall Fury at the John McCarthy Elementary School in Peabody. Atlantic Pro Wrestling returns Saturday, October 15th to the APW Arena in Newbury, Mass.
And for those New England Pro Wrestling independent wrestling fans, our main event at APW October 15th is about the biggest one of the biggest matches you're going to see in one of his final appearances in New England, the Firebrand Brian Fury, going to take on his longtime rival, the Kingpin Brian Malonis, for the APW Heavyweight Championship. Fury making his APW debut and looking to ruin the almost year-long reign of the Kingpin atop Atlantic Pro Wrestling. We're going to find out which one of these guys is going to get bragging rights as the guy to win one of their last match head-to-head.
So excited, so excited. Brian Fury is also going to be at the October 8th show in Peabody.
He fought Cody Rhodes recently, too, didn't he?
Yes, that was September 9th in Lowell for Chaotic, the Grand Slam show, whatever they called it.
Which, from what I heard, got great reviews. So congrats to those guys.
Very upset that I could not go to because I wanted it so bad.
A lot of great guys over at Chaotic, and give them a shout out. A lot of friends I have over there.
Absolutely.
Rich Palladino, my favorite wrestling on ring announcer. Hey, listen, Adam.
I will gladly take second place to Rich Palladino.
Right? I like Rich you. Rich is the godfather.
The only ring announcer I've ever seen who has his own T-shirt.
Yes.
Pretty fantastic.
I will say this. I will
proudly take second place to Rich Palladino.
I have made a career in independent wrestling, swimming in Rich Palladino's wake. Everywhere he goes, when he eventually leaves, I come in, and it's been kind of a trend through my career. So
that's all right. Todd Sopel's my pimp, so
there you go.
Yeah, but Brian Fury fighting for the, I think, the Liberty States Championship in a triple threat on the October 8th show. That's his final show with Liberty States. This is his grand retirement tour. Hell of a guy. He will be missed in the ring, absolutely, but he's helping the next generation at the New England Pro Wrestling Academy. So he's got.
And they're turning out some great students over there. So
hell yeah.
They're doing this.
Christian Casanovas, you got your Anthony Greens, you got all kinds of people coming out.
Like Hallo.
Yeah. So much love to Brian Fury on this program all the time.
Cam Sagami.
Well, yeah. Anyway, no.
Also, October 15th at APW, we're also going to feature a women's strap match, so not something you see very often. Vanity Vixen is going to go one-on-one with Mistress Belmont. So
indeed.
And TNA, for the love of God, sign Mistress Belmont. Seriously. Seriously. The TNA women's matches I've seen lately, God damn it, go out and sign Mistress Belmont. And John Poe. Bring John Poe in, too.
And Lucky Pro Wrestling returns to the Elks Lodge in Clinton, Massachusetts on October 29th with Fall Frenzy. So Fall Fury on October 8th, Fall Frenzy on October 29th.
Was that in Clinton, Massachusetts?
Clinton, Massachusetts. That's a great Elks Lodge.
But wait a second. But Elk Mania is not going to be in Clinton, Massachusetts?
No, Elk Mania is at the Beverly Hudson Elks Lodge in Beverly, Mass.
Okay. Big battle royal that night, I understand.
There is, for the vacant Bay State Championship, since Buddy Romano retired
Todd Sobel's in that too. Todd Sobel versus TK Orion in the Liberty States Showcase match. Look forward to that because TK is amazing.
TNA, sign TK Orion.
And I have not gotten to work with him recently, and that makes me sad.
TK's doing his thing. Congratulations to that guy. Fantastic. Big fan of TK Orion. If you guys aren't familiar with his work, go out and check him
out. Look him up.
This guy is going to be a star, and the one thing I will say that I love most about TK from my conversations with him to hearing interviews with him is the guy is just never satisfied, no matter how good his spot is, no matter how well he's doing. He always is hardest on himself, and he thinks he should be better than what he is, and that type of attitude is going to take you a very long way. Yeah. So,
hashtag sassy wild horse.
Yes, it's a Twitter, it's an Instagram thing. Look that shit up. Yes.
The picture of him in the statue the other day just made me laugh.
I think we've talked about it before, but we are very fortunate to work in the New England independent wrestling market. Yeah. Just, I mean, there is so much incredible young talent right now.
Ridiculous amounts.
It's really a renaissance of independent wrestling in the New England area right now. The guys we have, I mean, we run through them all the time. I mean, you talked about Christian Casanova. You didn't even mention Brick Mastone.
No, yeah, amazing. Scotty Slade,
Mark Sherman.
Who's been a Rosebud. For those of you watching Raw, he was a Rosebud a few times. I think most recently dressed up as a giant hot dog, as I recall.
Yeah. I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, but fuck it, I'm going to do it anyway. I think he's mentioned it on his podcast, the Wrestling Podcast About Nothing. But Kingpin Brian Malonis has a tryout with Ring of Honor coming up when they visit Mole. So that's going to be. We've got great veterans. We've still got guys like Demon Ortiz and Slick Wagner Brown and just so many tremendous, tremendous competitors in the area. It really is a hotbed of professional wrestling. And you look around the professional wrestling, the WWE, the TNA, just saturated with guys from this region. This is really where things are happening, and it's awesome to be a part of it. So hats off to all those guys busting their asses every weekend, putting on great shows for fans, and goddamn it, go out and support independent wrestling.
Yeah, we are lucky, lucky boys. Speaking of our Ring of Honor and all, did you hear the rumors about NXT TakeOver Boston sometime next year?
I have not heard that. I know they have TakeOver in Canada. I know think the next one after that is Japan.
Yeah, I heard sometime. I think I heard it was like early to mid 2017 is supposed to be TakeOver Boston.
I mean, it wouldn't shock me at all. I mean,
if that happens and I don't go to it, I will kill myself. So be on the lookout for that on a future episode of the Rundown.
Well, I mean, you didn't get to work the Fenway Park show. So.
yeah. Rub something out of your dick.
Well, you know, other ring announcers got to be there, you know. But in any event,
just you.
No, there was another ring announcer there. Was there? Oh, I didn't. I'll tell you that one in the host story later. hey, you could have come. We gave you the invitation. You had plans. But yeah, it wouldn't shock me if they did a takeover in Boston. Obviously, Hunter is a local guy. He came up through the area, so I know he does have an affinity for the region.
Killer Kowalski, which the Brian Fury school is actually kind of an offshoot of, like a successor of.
Yeah, they kind of picked up the mantle. You know, lots of schools have some degree of lineage based on the students to Killer Kowalski. I mean, that was Killer Kowalski's school was the school if you wanted to be a wrestler in New England for until he passed, at which point you started to see more schools pop up. So. So most schools can claim some type of lineage to Killer Kowalski's, but so the New England Pro Wrestling Academy has the, I guess, official lineage.
Yeah,
as it were.
Next time they do one of their one-day fantasy camps, we'll be sure to mention it on here as well. So, okay, back to plugging shit that nobody cares about. Stump Trivia every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. at the Port Tavern, Newburyport. I want to apologize to Ed Hunt, who went to this week's Stump Trivia at the Port Tavern, and I was not there because my son was sick. Huntsy finally showed up, and I wasn't there. So maybe next week.
Sorry. He would have just cheated anyway, so it's fine.
Oh, I'm sure. He said he was texting me. He's like, that guy was a hack. I'm like, I'm sorry. Follow us on Twitter @RundownPodcast. Send us an email to rundownwrestling@gmail.com. Call the hotline at 617-863-6967. 61 Rundown 7, Be Cool Like Tommy and Sal and sometimes Jackson, and leave us voicemails.
Troy was over there tonight. Sometimes we have Qubit, you know.
Oh, we haven't gotten on the chat room yet. I'm still talking about the hotline, but like us on Facebook. Tell your parents and your grandparents to like us on Facebook at facebook.com/rundownwrestling. Watch archived episodes at youtube.com/rundownpodcast, and circle me on Google Plus while that's still a thing at google.com/plusadam.
Just need to take that out of the top. That needs to stop being a thing. And by the way, I was kind of hoping your grandma was going to call tonight.
To make a donation of the monetary variety, go to paypal.me/rundownwrestling. It costs me $10 a month to host this on Podomatic. If you want to help out with that, it would be greatly appreciated. And if you like poetry, help Andy out at Chasing Distant Horizons at tinyurl.com/distanthorizons. Speaking of Andy,
it's poetry.
Speaking of Andrew, check out all the...
You're an asshole.
There we go. Check out all the podcasts on the Questionable Endeavor Network at Shadowvane at shadowvane.net. Support them at patreon.com/shadowvane. Check out Troy's show, the Geek and Gamer Guild. Check out Bill, Andy, and Josh on Tooning Japanese. And our good friend Henry Hugepex, the Suplex Throwing Human Duplex on the Raw Attitude podcast. That's on Mondays as well. It's a fun little show. I believe was it we talked about it in the host story, was it this week or next week that we get the Ahmed Johnson screaming fuck on live TV?
I think he says next week.
Was that next week's? Okay. So be on the lookout for that. Follow that at Quest End Network on Twitter. The website is questendnetwork.com for articles, live streams. There's forums. Please check out the forums. All kinds of fun stuff on there. You can check out all the episodes that have been posted of all of our Questionable Endeavor Network podcasts if you don't want to subscribe on iTunes or Stitcher.
Or also, where you can get the Ernie Award-winning 3 Up, 3 Down column every week.
Still have to Google that. I forgot to check iTunes for reviews, but I'm sure there's not a new one. If you cannot afford a monetary variety, leave us a review on iTunes. That helps. 5-star review helps other people find us. If you leave us a text review, we'll read your name and your text review at the end of a future episode.
And if you leave a 3-star review, you can watch the steam come from Adam's head.
It's there's nothing up here to stop it. So it just like a hot grill. Anyways. Search for us on iTunes, Stitcher, or Podomatic under the Rundown Wrestling Podcast. Thanks to Tegan Brown for the logo. Thanks to everyone for listening. Thanks to Sal and Sean and Troy and Jackson on the side in the chat room.
You don't even give me a chance to pimp my shit anymore. You just blow right past that. For those of you interested, follow me on Twitter at jstewart0920. You can follow Atlantic Pro Wrestling on Facebook. For Matt, you can get to see me make videos where I make matches that make guys cry. Also, YouTube, Atlantic Pro Wrestling, where you can see all of our events, including our last one, which was tremendous, and I encourage you to go check it out.
Yes, Atlantic Pro Wrestling on YouTube. I'm internet famous. So there's that.
And I encourage you to participate in the Confused Adam meme and spread that like wildfire across the internet.
Yes, please. Big fan of that. Thank you, Jason.
Thank you, Adam.
For taking time out of your week to talk to this asshole.
Hey, I am never too busy to get all up in the ear holes of the fans of the Rundown.
We didn't talk about the DX wall. Why is it a DX wall this week?
Because I said, Jackson, what do you want me to put on the wall this week? And he said, all the members of DX.
There you go. All right.
So.
All right. And on that note, thank you, I Fight Dragons at ifightdragons.com for the theme song. Next week, we will talk about Clash of Champions. And then the week after that, we'll predict No Mercy. And then the week after that, we'll talk about No Mercy.
I will say from No Mercy to Survivor Series, I think it's about 6 weeks, so we might get a break there for a while.
As always, Jacob, good night and good luck. Bree, Zong, go fuck yourself.
Where the fuck are those guys?
No idea. They're hanging out with the Golden Truth. Happy birthday, Jackson.
Yes, it was Tuesday. It was Jackson's birthday.
Got it in there. And
If anybody wants to send presents, feel free to make a donation to my bank account in his name.
Somebody had a little iTunes spree.
Yeah, there you go.
Unapproved iTunes spree.
Yeah. Luckily, I caught it when I did, because probably could have gotten a lot worse. For those of you parents out there, if you're handing your kid your iPhone or your, make sure you put restrictions on and disable in-app purchases.
Certainly. And lastly, as always, take care, Bulby faces.
I actually forgot to download Skype on this computer, so I'm going to have to do that before you can send me anything. So let's go to Skype.com and start that process now. I only use this laptop for trivia now. So.
Yeah. And porn.
Nope, just trivia.
And porn.
No, that's what the phone's for.
The screen is so small. When I'm watching POV stuff, it makes my junk look huge by comparison.
Gross.
All right.
There we go. Now comes the fun part while you watch me install Skype before we get to the voicemail. There we go.
Viewers, okay. We're losing all our viewers.
Well, we started with four, and then Jackson went to bed, and then Troy had to put Lucy to bed, and so now it's just Sal and Sean. Okay.
I have to do this on the website because the first one came through as no transcript, so.
Come on, Google Voice. Get your shit together. No, I don't want to make Bing my search engine. Fuck you. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I am here to talk about one of the flagship program of the WWE. And you know what this week's episode? Wasn't that there was actually pretty good now. I know there's this whole dynamic of them doing things on Wrong way too soon. But it's a double-edged sword because if they don't do exciting matches on Raw, for example, Kevin Owens versus Roman Reigns in a steel cage, then they're going to get killed by Monday Night Football every week. They're going to get killed by Monday Night Football. So they definitely need to keep the ratings up, and I think rein so into the cage for the highlighted one of their pay-per-views. And now you've already seen it. But again, what can you do if you got to get to the data queue program? I thought it was a good match. I was a little bit surprised that the ending, not Reigns winning, but the aftermath of Riverside coming out and then having Rollins come down to make the safe. Why would Wrongs come down to make the same other than he said he wanted to be a paid Stephanie so that I get that connection storyline-wise, but I think we all know that they have been validating for a chance of the Shield reunion and Evil would be. Do you know Machine, you know on the other show, if they can have a reason to get set in the ring with Roman on the safe side, they will. But I don't expect anything on this just yet. I'm a do reunite. The Shield, it will probably be a Person 5 series or Royal Well, both hoping that nature. Now, as far as the rest of Rocco's, I thought the cursor waste a lot of time, which was surprising, and I know the people away, but they got two segments. I thought they all did good, and I actually agree with the winter because you have plenty of time to build up guys like Cedric Alexander, and which one give it to the veteran that everybody knows he can go in there and have an awesome match and put TJ over? I don't think Ryan Kendrick winned unless no TJ Perkins. Just won that title. I don't think Ryan Kendrick with it all, but go in now, put the kiddos. But make the crowd champagne and dad for Brian Kendrick and do. Now one Potter Road. It was very confusing as how they took all the mid-cars of Rock, shoved them into one batch. It was kind of like they didn't have enough time to go through individual storylines, so they were just going to take Due Date and the Club and Jericho and Sammy Thing and ends on gas tank size and just shut them all in 1-10 and 10. And that's me what throw away, and none of those guys should be throwing away anytime. But God knows I don't want Rana to be 4 hours. But, you know, you could cut out the other things, but you know how they are, although. I will say this. I did enjoy the backstates. I went between. This came up really tiny. Holy shit.
That's what she said.
Last, Three stupid fucking Google voicemail. All I was going to say is I enjoyed the segment backstage between Seth Rolls and 70 Wake Me, and I thought those two have really good chemistry, and I like the back and forth. I actually like Seth, Steph said, well, if I knew that your life is going to do it. Maybe he would have done it because of this, that, the other thing. It was almost like with OJ. Wrote that book, if I kill the Coles, my wife. So that was interesting because they obviously are going to have that play out with Triple. H comes back, and you know, for all purposes, you might be coming back at Class Champion. So we so see Class of Champions card that doesn't look too bad. But what they need to do is it further storylines and make interesting booking decisions as far as who's going over some of these matches. I definitely need to see some title change in. I don't know who, but somebody's got to see it. And you know, maybe it's the club. But I'll talk to you guys later because it's Adam Point Router. I always seem to call frequently very point all right. Bye. Hey, how you doing? It's your boy Call Me Martha signed to here this morning. You can call me Crema because I'm at the DMV trying to get some good old coffee and that cold brew style. Well, I want to talk to you guys about Tuesday Night SmackDown Wife, but I thought the show was amazing. I thought it was really good. There's a lot of good things that happened on SmackDown Live, but unfortunately, you know, I got to stop with the Bed Apollo group. There's this guy, the next purse Axel is the next Bull Dallas. He is getting married, not even looking competitive against my record in their image. Just using him to set up a few with. Cool being in Jack's way. I go. So what is a Joel with Apollo because he gets no mic time? I know he has no personality anyway, but there still is literally being wasted, and he's going to end up being the next Curves Axel. This sucks. I have felt problem, Paul Cruz, but apparently they go. Also, speaking to people, Kim Berry, I like the fact that me Scott protected and an Ice-T title match, they kept the belt on him. They had me calling Maurice because that's in a bag that they might get to the title to take well. What the problem is, as good co-hos, Jason pointed out Ziegler's story hasn't changed since March. He's the guy who he's going to do the big fight last as last year and every time you get this last chance. He doesn't win, so tell me a favor, send this guy. There's no point in him doing the stick continuously. Look what they look. What is it did for AJ when they turn his age? It was amazed. It last night, now the next week. We're going to get the one on the rematch with AJ Styles and Dean Ambrose. I don't think they're going to switch the belt, but I think it's Radius crap. I think people will tune in to see a Jay Parsons, Ambrose Bars, the women go Becky and Alexa Bliss killed it in that opening provo. I love the work. They do it. I believe actually really looking forward to this message. Talk to you guys later.
Hate that Radius crap. Ugh. There you go. Gotta get it.
You know, in response to that voicemail intro that Adam leaves when you called the rundown voicemail is the death penalty fighting Rusa because you know the one of my all right just real quick couple of thoughts on NXT. Samoa Joe coming out there with the medical records listing of everything. He's done Tanaka more talking about his recovery time is 6 o'clock weeks, saying that he won't wait 6 weeks. He won't wait 12 weeks. Regal needs to come out there and award him the title. That was great. That was absolutely great. That was like some classic. You shit that. You would have seen like the Million Dollar Man do or somebody like a Jim Cornette. That was amazing. Also, the fact that Joe said that he's now going to decimate Regal's entire roster until he gets it once, that's going to make some interesting and XE shows over the next couple weeks. I think we all know Nakamura will defend his NFC championship against Joe in Canada, but that's not till November. So would be interesting. I do like how they're playing this out. I think at one point Boston Aries attempted to GPS and his match that went horribly wrong in the camera. I had to cut away real quick. Don't do it if you can't do it. Don't do it, and as far as the main event between Being Honest and the NXT debut of Cedra Tales in what a great match, that was a great match. That was a perfect 15-minute match for the main event and XT. Loved it, though. That was absolutely perfect. That's about all I can say, but I next see other than the women that they're currently having the division. They just don't feel important. I don't know, maybe because the Elka promos. Maybe Kids is no built their character anyway. I think Billy Keys are a good wrestler, but I don't know I shouldn't feel big time like Charlotte. They're like Sasha did. I don't know, maybe I just got to get the machines, but even Live and Morgan. She just seems out of her league standing next to Hospice, but I'll talk to you guys later.
Last one?
Yeah, that's the last one.
Those were fat this week. Nothing big.
Yeah, there's nothing.
But I got Skype.
Nothing made me wet in the pants on that one, so.
I'll never live up to Victoria the Fuck Fuck.
Yeah, I think that's, dude, you were just all staticky all of a sudden. Good thing that didn't happen during the show. Yeah, I think we'll never bit big ass, big titties.
Ass and titties. Ass and titties. Ass titties. Ass and titties.
Sounds like a good weekend.
On that note.
Good. They're updating Skype. Yay, that shouldn't take fucking forever.
Thanks, YouTube. I'll see you next week, guys.
Later.
Bye.
Yeah.
Love you, YouTube. Call me.